In this review, we'll be looking at the HFC box cannon. But before we go into the review itself, let's have a little history. The Mauser first saw the light of day as a prototype in 1895. The following year, it entered production and was designated the C96. This 7.63mm pistol for integral 10-round box magazine quickly gained popularity. Notable users include Winston Churchill and Lawrence of Arabia. The first notable variant came in the shape of the M1916. Due to the slow production of the .08 Luger, Mauser were contracted to produce the pistol in 9mm. These pistols became known as the Red 9. This was because of the Red 9 on the handle. This was to avoid confusion with a 7.63mm version. Because of the Treaty of Versailles, the barrel length of German-made pistols was restricted to a length of no longer than 4 inches. Mauser complied and produced the M1921. The Bolshevik government bought these pistols in large numbers. Eventually, the M1921 became known as the Bolo, Bolo being short for Bolshevik. 1932 saw the introduction of the Select Fire M1932 Schnellfeuer. Besides the Select Fire option, this pistol also had a detachable 10-round or 20-round magazine. Although this pistol was largely intended for export to China, small numbers were also sold to the Wehrmacht during the Second World War, where it was designated the M712. The Mauser C96 was also cloned by other manufacturers. The Spanish Astra company produced a copy. Oddly enough, Astra produced a Select Fire version before Mauser did. The other major country to produce a Mauser clone was China. Due to the shortage of 7.63mm ammunition, a .45 ACP cartridge version was locally produced. This pistol became popular with Chinese warlords who dubbed it the Box Cannon. With the history of the pistol and the origins of the term box cannon dealt with, we can now look at what HFC have produced. This pistol is almost all metal. The only plastic that's visible are the grips, the end of the fake firing pin, a retainer, and the mechanism frame. Everything else is metal. The upper and lower receiver castings have a CNC machined quality to them. There are no sharp edges or rough surfaces. Even the inside of the magwell feels smooth and only slight casting marks are visible. The fit between the upper and lower receiver is reasonable. There is some slop, but I've seen other pistols where it is a lot worse. Being mostly metal, the pistol is quite heavy. The ladder sight on the top is functional and works correctly as per the real steel. However, being an airsoft replica, the sight is more decorative than functional. A useful feature is the external hop adjustment screw. On some pistols, it's a bit of a faff to adjust the hop, but on this pistol, it's quite possible to fire and adjust the hop at the same time. The inner barrel is brass. I've no idea what the bore measures, but it appears to be well made. The selector lever on the side is non-functional. It is possible to change the position by removing the screw on the other side, but other than that, it doesn't affect the function of the Mauser. The safety lever sits next to the hammer. It's a simple thumb-operated affair and is marked S for safe and F for fire. On the other side of the magwell sits the mag release button. This button is pretty much flush mounted. Being flush mounted, it's unlikely to be accidentally operated, but it's easy to operate by the user. The lanyard ring on the bottom of the pistol grip looks cheap. It probably is, and was added as an afterthought. Being a non-blowback pistol, there are no other moving parts. The pistol is painted a type of gunmetal grey. Although the colour may not be to everyone's tastes, some prefer black, the shade does look authentic. This Mauser is a number of years old and has been skirmished. Even so, there are no scratches or other battle scars. The only places where the paint has suffered the wear and tear of gaming is where the pistol has been taken out and put back into its holster. The paintwork is durable and of good quality. The fake wood grips are a little disappointing, but I have seen better fake wood and other replicas. On the plus side, it is possible to buy real steel grips and replace the plastic ones that somewhat let this pistol down. Under normal circumstances, pistols, real steel or otherwise, have some sort of trademarks on them. Real steel pistols also bear a number of proof marks. Some airsoft manufacturers put on fake or apocryphal markings on the replicas to avoid copyright infringement issues. However, the HFC box cannon has no markings whatsoever. HFC did produce a trademark version of this pistol, but the price point made it very expensive. Another point to be considered is that the HFC box cannon isn't a specific model of Mauser. It has a detachable magazine, so it isn't a C96. It isn't a full auto model of Mauser, so it's not an M712. It's not even a direct copy of a Chinese box cannon. So what trademarks do you put on it? I suspect that HFC decided to leave the trademarks off to reduce costs, and they couldn't find a suitable set of trademarks to put on it in the first place. This does leave the owner the option to use an engraving tool and to add their own trademarks. Han Solo Blaster, anyone? The HFC Mauser uses a double action mechanism. Each pull of the trigger chains a BB, cocks the action, trips the hammer, which knocks a spring-loaded firing pin. This firing pin strikes the gas release valve on the magazine, which propels the BB down the barrel. Being an airsoft pistol, some alterations have been made to get the pistol to work. The real steel firing pin on the rear of the pistol is a fake. The actual firing pin is sighted below this pin and is struck by the lower part of the hammer. The hammer has had an extra face added to it to allow this pin to be struck. Operation is simplicity itself. Insert a loaded and gassed magazine into the pistol, move the safety lever from safe to fire, and you're good to go. There's no cocking to worry about, but since this isn't a blowback pistol, it will continue to fire even though the magazine has run out of ammo. It's a small price to pay for simplicity. Because this pistol uses a double action mechanism, it uses a number of levers and springs to cycle the action. The gas in the magazine only served to propel the BB. These levers and springs are sighted on both sides of a plastic frame that sits inside the lower receiver. None of these components are fixed to that plastic frame. The inside walls of the lower receiver keeps the internals in place. The frame is secured to the lower receiver by a screw that passes from one side of the receiver through to the other and screws into the fake change lever on the other side. The change lever serves no other purpose. Once the screw is removed, the upper receiver and the plastic frame can be slid backwards as a single unit and out of the lower receiver. However, the levers and springs will fly out, and there's a good chance that the carpet monster will eat them. I've had this pistol apart a number of times, and it's a devil to get back together. You need three hands and an anti-gravity device. So if you value your sanity, don't take this pistol apart. If you have taken your Mauser apart and can't get it back together again, you're better off buying another one, as I'm pricing myself out of the market for fixing them. Two magazine sizes are available, long, about 26 rounds, and short, about 17 rounds. Both are well made and finished in the same colour as the pistol. The valves seem to be unique to this gun. If you've got a leaky mag, you've got a problem, as replacement valves are not available. The valves can be dismantled so the O-rings can be replaced, but a lack of spare valves I consider to be a shortcoming. Loading the mags are problematic. The BB guide doesn't have a latch to keep it at the bottom of the magazine for loading. There's no feed lips, just a hole. You need to keep your finger behind the hole to stop the BBs rolling out the other side when you're loading. In short, you need three hands to load a mag. The fit of the magazines in the mag well isn't very good. They slop about, but at least they are secure. The magazine release button sits flush with the body of the gun, so it is unlikely to be accidentally knocked and the magazine released. The Mauser has been out for a number of years. As of yet, I've not seen a single upgrade for this gun. No tight ball barrels, no improved hop rubbers, nothing. The same applies to spare parts. In essence, if this pistol breaks, it's scrap. Having said that, I've not seen or heard of a single case of a broken HFC Mauser. Perhaps HFC doesn't supply spare parts because the pistol is so reliable. Accessories are in short supply as well. At this time, there are only two HFC produced accessories, the short magazine and the holster shoulder stock. Although the holster shoulder stock is nice to have, it's pretty useless without the leather rig that it sits in. At this time, replica real steel leather rigs are available. The HFC produced soldier stock is expensive for what it is. Replica real steel shoulder stocks for the Mauser C96 are available, and sometimes they're cheaper than the HFC counterpart. Be warned though, the real steel Mauser C96 shoulder stock will not fit the HFC pistol without modification. So, if you're handy with a Dremel and a file, a cheap real steel Mauser C96 shoulder stock is worth looking for. Now that the actual pistol has been reviewed, it's time to see how it performs. The Mauser will be subjected to two tests, the chronograph test and the accuracy test. So without further ado, let's put the HFC box cannon through its paces. So on to results of the chronograph test. I used Abbey Ultra Gas at a temperature of approximately 20 degrees Celsius. I fired a string of 27 shots. The average over those 27 shots was 281 FPS. The number of shots within a plus minus 10 FPS range was 20. For a stock, out the box, unmodified gun, these results are acceptable. Now, on to the accuracy test. Okay, it's Captain Sky. Deal with it. Apparently he's indestructible or something. I admit, the sights aren't all that brilliant. It's taken four shots just to hit him. Yeah, that shot did hit him. It hit him in the shoulder. Quite in slow motion. For the accuracy test, I used a target that was approximately 1 foot tall at a distance of 10 yards. This equates to a target that is approximately 6 foot tall at a distance of 60 yards. On to the results of the accuracy test. 27 shots were fired. There were 20 hits. This equates to a 74% hit rate. Again, for a stock, out-the-box, unmodified gun, these results are acceptable. On the downside, the HFC box cannon is neither a Mauser C96 or a M712, nor is it a box cannon. It's not any specific model of Mauser, but an amalgam of several different ones. Thus, it scores low on the accuracy level. Because of this, the HFC box cannon is unlikely to appeal to milsimmers. Although this quasi-Mauser has no trademarks, the more expensive trademark pistol is still a quasi-Mauser, so the extra expense isn't worth it. Because of the magazine loading difficulties, reloading in the field isn't exactly practical. Extra magazines are available, but how many would you need to make this pistol skirmishable? The construction design isn't user-friendly. Normal maintenance and servicing is only really possible with the most ardent of owners. The more casual owner is limited to a damp cloth and silicone spray. On the upside, the HFC box cannon is a very robust pistol. The thick metal construction ensures that the pistol is durable and can take plenty of knocks while gaming and still keep going. This makes this pistol ideal as a loner or for a newer player. The double action mechanism is reliable and unlikely to fail during the game. Both the accuracy and consistency of shots are perfectly acceptable for an out-the-box gun. By far the biggest plus point for the HFC box cannon is the price point. It retails for under £100. All points considered, the HFC box cannon is a good value pistol.